Hello, everyone. Welcome to Living Kabbalah class. Today is the 15th day of the Kabbalistic month. It's the full moon of the month of Sagittarius. A very positive day. A lot of opportunity, a lot of light available for us to draw, to bring down into our life, into our consciousness. And before we start, gonna do a powerful life-transforming Ana Bekoach meditation, and also we want to set intention for tonight's class about what do we want to change, what do we want to transform, what perspective, what view, what the mindset, what quote-unquote blockage we want to break and change in our life. So let's start. The first line is Chesed. Ana bekoach, gedulat yeminecha, tatir tzerura. Alef bet gimel, yutav tzadik. It's the line that connects us directly to the Tree of Life reality, connects us to the flawless universe, the perfected world, where no chaos, no negativity exists. Just pure light. It's also the world where all the answers are available. Any questions that we might have are available here. We want to send this light to all the people in the world. Want to awaken memory, to remember anything that we forgot maybe. We want to also ask the light for help, ask the creator to help in any area of our life, to remove any blockages and connect us to the energy of creation. Second line, Gevura. Kabel rinat, amecha sagveinu, ta'areinu nora. Kuf resh ayin, sintat nun. This line spells out the word kara satan, which means to rip out the satan, rip out our opponent, rip out all false beliefs, all negative energy, all impurity, all fears, doubt, resentment, regret, hate, limitations, everything to be completely wiped off from our consciousness, from our surroundings, and send it back to the light. Also, we are meditating to close all the gates through which Satan enters our consciousness. And also the ability to say no. And most importantly, to be able to differentiate the difference between us and the opponent. And that's the theme of today's class also. Third line, Tiferet. Na gibor dorshe yehudecha kevavat shomerem. Nun gimel daled yud kavshim. This line brings us balance, ability to detach, to restrict. Nun gimel daled, the first three letters bring abundance and sustenance into all of our businesses, all of our money matters, ability to also awakening the consciousness and energy of tithing. Yud Kaf Shin is the most powerful sequence for healing. We want to meditate that this energy enters every single cell, DNA of our body to repair everything that we want to make whole again. Meditate on other people that need healing also. And send it also to any place in the world where there is a lot of darkness, where we want to transform that energy. And fourth line, Netzach, Barchem, Tarem, Rachamei, Tzitkatecha, Tamid, Gamlem. Bet Etresh, Tzaditav, Gimel. This line awakens the absolute certainty that the Creator is with us at all times, in every single process, every step of the way, assisting us and fuses us with the consciousness, with the understanding that everything is perfect. Everything happens for a perfect reason. and everything in front of us, we are able to overcome. Fifth line, Chod. Hasin kadosh berov tuvcha nachel adatecha. Chet kubet et nun ayin connects us to Ruach HaKodesh, or divine inspiration. Gives us ability to be in the right place at the right time, speaking the right words. Also understanding how to use the wisdom of Kabbalah in our everyday life to open our consciousness. Sixth line, Yisod. Yachid ge'e le'emcha p'nei zochrei kedushatecha. Yud gimelamet pe'izayin kuf. This line connects us to six millennia, to the time when the wisdom of Kabbalah is becoming available and accessible to everyone in the world, to support all the projects of the Kabbalah Center, to spread this wisdom to the whole world, as well as understanding and awakening deeper insights and secrets in our own life, and amplifying the attribute of peace and tranquility within us. Seventh line, Malchut. Shavateinu kabel, ushma tzakateinu, yodea ta'alumot. Shinku vav tzadik yutach. This line brings renewal, rejuvenation, the feeling of newness, the feeling of starting for the first time, living every single moment of our life as if we just were created. Connecting to the seventh millennium, when there will be no more chaos, no more tikkun, and understanding there's no end in light. Light is endless. Any end is only our illusion. And before we say this, the last line, we want to meditate to bring all of this energy to our physical reality, to our body, and to protect it. We whisper the connection, and let's begin our class. So we are in the portion of Vaishlach. We're in the month of Sagittarius. This is the different energies that are happening, the different consciousness that's happening. We are in the middle of the month of Sagittarius, which is a very positive, very optimistic month. It's the month of wisdom, month of revelation, month of adventure, month of moving forward, month of letting go of everything that doesn't serve us. It's the full moon on Gemini. Gemini, as we know, is also a communicator. Also sign that's connected to wisdom, sign that's connected to intellect, to the wisdom of Kabbalah, to revelation. It's a very powerful day. It's a very powerful time. We have, as Kabbalists teach, the assistance of all the righteous souls that had ever lived are with us tonight. So we have so much potential tonight. We really want to extract all the light, all the mochin, what's called in Hebrew, it's called mochin, all the light that's available for us to be drawn to our consciousness to change our life completely. So let's begin. The portion is called Veishlach. It's a very interesting portion, one of my favorites, one of my personal favorites. Something very special happens in this portion particularly. We're continuing the stories of Jacob, the patriarch. He's helping us build the central column. He's responsible for central column. He created the central column, the ability to restrict, the ability to look at things from a different perspective, from a different angle, from a different point of view. That's what he's all about. And he is here with us. He's assisting us today to help us do that. And it says he was the most perfected of all the patriarchs. Out of between Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, it says Jacob was the most perfected. He really perfected his column. He really perfected his role and ability to manifest light in the world. And in this week's portion, he leaves his father-in-law's house, Laban, and where he married. He has now two wives, and he has 11 boys, 11 kids, and one daughter. And he accumulated a tremendous amount of wealth. He's probably one of the wealthiest people in the world at this point. And he becomes very, very big, you can say, in the world. And right in the beginning of a portion, It's the most interesting section where he is meeting his brother. He's about to meet his brother, and his brother's name is Esau, and he, someone that really didn't like Jacob. Esau really hated, it says that he hated, literally hated all his essence, he hated Jacob. And he promised, he kind of made like a promise, I'm going to kill him when I see him. And we'll go through a portion of the 1% of it. And then Jacob has a very interesting point section where he crosses a river and he realizes he forgot something on the other side. He goes back and he stays there a whole night and he goes through a very special battle. Then that's what we're going to focus on the most. There's also the part about where Jacob and Esau finally meet. And they talk and they say, how you've been? We haven't seen each other for 20 years. Rebecca passes away in this week's portion. And then another incident happens, which again connects us to soulmates, which is the part of Shem and Dinah. Dinah was the daughter of Jacob. And Shem was a son of a king in the city where Jacob started to dwell. And basically what happens is this... Prince Shem rapes Jacob's daughter out of love. He falls very much in love with her and he loses control and literally rapes her. And there's a whole incident there and what happens, and it connects us to soulmates again. And we also then go into the birth of Benjamin, the final son of Jacob, Benjamin. Yaakov and Benjamin have their final son, and Rachel passes away also. So there's a lot of support of righteous souls that leave the world in this week's portion. And there's also the very deep section about talking about different kings that ruled the land of Israel before. Way before the Israelites went there, which actually connects us to also the tikkun of the world. And I'm very sorry, just 1 second, I'm going to interrupt for just a few seconds. If you want, use this time to think about, again, the issue of what you want to remove, what you want to change and transform. What life, it can be very 1% and can be very internal, but what do you want to change in your life? Okay. And we're back, short break. So we really want to focus on something that we want to change and transform. We want to go, always remember the basics of Kabbalah, which is transformation, change of our consciousness, change of our reactive nature. And we're going to use the story that Jacob goes through, where Jacob is, go back to the part where Jacob, you know, is moving. He's very afraid to meet his brother. He's not sure what's going to happen because Esau is a murderer. He's a killer. He doesn't really care. He could easily kill him. That's what he swore to do. But Jacob understands that it all depends on him. It doesn't really depend on Esau. He's just, you can say, like a puppet of Jacob's opponent. And what Jacob realizes is that I have to go inward. I have to go in. I have to go deep. I have to go inside. I can't be on the outside, which just perfectly matches with this month, perfectly matches with the time that we're in. Because Sagittarius is not someone that goes necessarily inward. It's not a natural sign that goes in, deep within and see what I'm feeling, see what I'm going through. And I ask myself, what is the reason that this is happening in my life, whatever it might be? So Jacob transfers all his kids to one side of a bank, and then he realizes he forgot one flank of olive oil that he needs to go back, and he doesn't want to lose it. He doesn't want to disregard it. He shows us appreciation. He shows us that it's important to appreciate things that are in our life, and it's important to appreciate everything that you have. No matter how much you owe, you should still appreciate it. And this always connects and reminds me of Karen, because Karen would not waste the tiniest things. If there was something the smallest things, like turning the lights off in the centers and, you know, making sure we don't waste anything, et cetera. It's very, very much how Karen lived her life. And both Rav and Karen, by the way, they all did that. So he goes back and he spends the whole night there. And it says that he wrestles a man. But then it's very interesting, as they wrestle through the night, the man turns into an angel all of a sudden. And as day starts to break, he tells Jacob, release me because I need to go and do my duties in the upper world. And then after that, he actually blesses Jacob. He actually, instead of just leaving, he blesses Jacob. So it's a very interesting story. And on the outside, it looks like he was battling a person. It looks like he was battling a human being. And in the beginning, Jacob's perception was that he needs to battle Esau, that that's his enemy. But as he starts to develop, as he starts to go deeper, as he starts to connect more and more to the Creator, he realizes that it has nothing to do with that person and all has to do with Jacob. And the main point of today's class is to reawaken our understanding of what is the opponent. Who is the opponent? What is the opponent? What's his role? Why he exists? And that really our life changes the most when we go through the relationship of us and our opponent. What is our opponent? What do I mean? The opponent in Hebrew, it's called Satan. In Aramaic, it's called Satan, actually, which literally means opponent, means somebody who pushes back. And if we go back to the story of creation, what Rav Ashlag teaches us, that how our world was created, the vessel wanted to be the cause, right? The vessel wanted to be the reason why it has fulfillment. And we spoke about it in previous classes also, in last week's class, I think. And Jacob literally gives us a life lesson that if you want to change, if you want to grow, if you want to be happy, if you want to achieve, you have to face your opponent. You have to. You don't have a choice. You will go through that process voluntarily or involuntarily, because on a subconscious soul level, we want to go through this process. We want to go through this process of becoming less religious mindset, less strict, less connected to physicality, and become much more spiritual, become truly spiritual beings, become who we want to be, become somebody who's connected to the light with no separation at all whatsoever. And he gives the biggest secret to this whole process. The opponent asks, you know, after they go through the battle, I'm going to read it to you. They go through the battle, you know. So Jacob was left alone, and the men wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overcome him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip, so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with him. The man said, let me go, for it is daybreak. But Jacob replied, I will not let you go unless you bless me. He asked him, what is your name? Jacob. He answered. Then the man said, your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with men and have overcome. Jacob said, please tell me your name. And the man replies, why do you ask my name? That's the answer. And this is the biggest secret in your spiritual growth. That your opponent, his one of his main job, his number one step job, is to tell you, why do you even want to do spiritual work? Why do you think that there's no separation between me and you? There's no difference. I am you. The shyness, the fear, the doubts, the anger, the sadness, the frustration, the disbelief, the anger, the resentment, this is you. Why are you asking for my name? Why are you trying to figure me out? Do not try to figure me out. So one of the number one jobs, the number one job of the opponent, is to prevent us from even thinking that it has anything to do with us internally, with our consciousness. It has nothing to do with us. It has everything to do with the other person. Now think about the issue that you might be going through. Think about, you know, whatever it is that you want to change, overcome, transform, etc. Can you fully understand that the change that needs to take place is inside your consciousness? That's the only change that needs to take place. It has nothing to do with the outside. It has nothing to do with other people. It has nothing to do with the world. It has nothing to do with politics, your boss, the relationship that you're in. Nothing. It has nothing to do with that. It all has to do with your consciousness, with the relationship you have either with yourself, the creator, and then it comes to people around you. But mostly it has to do with the relationship between you and yourself and you and the creator. So Satan's main job is to tell us there's no need to do spiritual work. Don't look for me. You're not going to find me. I am you. I am you. I am your, all your false belief. That's who you are. You know, your whatever it might be, your doubt, your anger, your sadness, your depression, your doubts, your victim consciousness. This is who you are. You're not anything different. You're not anything else besides that. So the Satan is always going to his first step. He has a way of working. He has a certain formula. He doesn't just, you know, he's not a human being. He's an angel. He's an angelic entity. So he performs one function. His function is to make sure that you're constantly growing. Now, if you are in, for example, sports, one of my favorite examples, and you want to, you know, win the other team, you have to know that there is another team. And you want to know as much as possible about the other team. If you keep going around and saying, oh, the other team doesn't exist, it's an illusion. You know, you're going to eventually meet with the news that it's not true. If you don't study your team, it's also not going to be a good result because you want to know your opponent. You want to know what you're going against. If I want to be successful in my life, I need to know myself. I need to know all the pros and all the cons in me. I need to know what I'm good at. I need to know that, yes, I have these gifts. I have these abilities. I can, for example, me personally, I know that I can think very quick. I know that I can see the big picture very quickly. I know that I can see what other people need to change most of the time very quickly. I get messages. You know, I'm a quick communicator. I can communicate things easily. Those are my gifts. I'm intuitive. You know, I need to know all my gifts, but I also need to know what my opponent is. For example, before I started teaching classes, my opponent was preventing me from giving classes and teaching every possible way. Every possible way. Every possible way, from my thoughts to my surroundings to my feelings, everything was telling me don't do it. Everything. Everything. And there was no, you know, and it was just like, yeah, I don't need to teach. I don't need to teach classes. I can just keep, you know, meeting students one-on-one and that's it. That's all I need to do. You know, and until I started to really look and see what is my next level, what's my next level of growth, what's my next level of development, who am I not revealing of myself yet? Only then I start to realize, you know what, I think I should start teaching. Did it require a process of overcoming? 100%. 100%. It required a lot of effort, a lot of meditation, a lot of study, a lot of physical work, etc. But I had to be on this journey. I had to be on this journey to understand that there has to be something that I have to overcome that's not necessarily comfortable for me. Life is all about going outside of your comfort zone. The opponent is always going to tell you, stay in your comfort zone. There's absolutely no reason for you to go outside of your comfort zone. Absolutely no reason, right? That's one of his main tricks. So we're going to learn more of his tricks tonight. One of his main first tricks is to tell you that he doesn't exist. Number one, in Kabbalah, if you want to eventually go through a threshold in the beginning classes, you have to admit that you have an opponent, that your main job is to overcome your opponent. And this is something that's going to stay with you until we finish Tikkun. This is not something that just changes. The work of overcoming your opponent is the meaning of being in this physical reality. That's it. There's no other meaning of being in this physical reality. There's no, you know, there's many other things that we can do. But really, if you want to be happy, you need to make sure, you need to understand that my job is to find my opponent. And he's always going to tell you, why are you looking for me? Why do you want to know who I am? Why do you want to know the root of me? Why do you want to get rid of me? You know, he's always going to tell you. So his, what are some tricks? This class, the good thing is about this month, the sign of Sagittarius, that means that we all have this, is it's very accomplishing. It loves challenges. It loves things that it can't have, and it wants to overcome. It wants to compete. So it loves competition. It has a huge desire for an adrenaline. You know, Aquarius is, Sagittarius is love. Adrenaline. They love the adrenaline rush. They love, you know, the look for challenges and overcoming them. But they need to understand that the biggest challenge that exists and the only challenge that they really need to be focused on is with their opponent. There's no other real challenge that exists. So I need to know, I need to have a literally the profile, breakdown profile of my opponent. I need to know exactly what my opponent is made out of. What does he tell me? What kind of qualities? What does he tell me to ignore? Who does he tell me to not dislike? Who does he tell me to judge? Who does he tell me to blame? Who does he tell me to be upset at? That's his job. So I really need to have literally a breakdown, a profile, a character profile of my opponent. Literally, like a breakdown. For example, obviously astrology is a great tool to find out who your opponent is, other people are, self-discovery and spirituality, meditation. These are all great tools to get a better glimpse and understanding who is your opponent. Because if you don't know your opponent, you are very much likely to be wasting your time in spirituality. You really want to go in and ask, who is my opponent? What kind of an opponent does Michael Ocher have? What kind of an opponent does any one of us have? So his number one step is not to to push us away from the spiritual work of finding him. His other side is that he's constantly changing. He's an angel, so he can transform it in an instant. He can work 25 hours, 8 days a week. He has no limits. He doesn't have physical limitations. He doesn't need to take breaks. He doesn't need to, you know, get any support. He has everything that he needs at his disposal. He already has our whole growth charted out for us, for him also, what he needs to do. So once we change, he's also eventually going to change. So that kind of makes it fun. That makes it exciting that, you know, that once you transform, he's always going to change also. Just like in any good match or any good opponent in sports, for example. If you want to have fun, you need to have somebody who's equal to you. So once you overcome him, he's going to amp up his game as well. What are some other tricks that he uses? He is always going to tell you to stay in your comfort zone. He's always going to tell you, do not go outside of what discomforts you. Whatever is your comfort zone, stay in it. Don't break out of it. Stay in your comfort zone. Be comfortable. Don't change. Don't transform. He's always going to tell you to blame the other person. He's going to give you the best reasons, the best excuses, the best logic to tell you why the other person is the one that has a problem and not you. That's another job that another amazing thing that he does. He will prevent you from looking at life in a more optimistic way. Whenever you have a challenge, one of the amazing tricks that Kabbalists teach us is to be a little bit more optimistic, to know that you can overcome it, to have full certainty that I can overcome this challenge. And it's actually already overcome in a reality, in a parallel universe, in a parallel reality. It's only about me accessing that self that we need to do. But he's going to tell you that that doesn't exist and you can't even do that. You cannot do that is one of his cards. He loves to make us quit. When we start a spiritual journey and we don't necessarily see the result right away, he's going to tell you, give up. What do you don't see? You're not getting what you want. Why are you trying to receive something that you are not able to obtain? He's always going to tell you to give up. That's another trick that he absolutely has to use on us all the time. That's why people that are persistent, that are consistent, have much easier spiritual work. Much more, it's much easier for them, and they are guaranteed success. But he's going to tell you that you cannot accomplish it, and look at all the proof. He's always going to tell you to judge yourself. He's always going to tell you, you should judge yourself, and you are at fault. You are no good. You can't do this. You can't accomplish it. You don't even try. Don't even try to accomplish it. Don't even try to get it. You are no good. Self-judgment. He's going to inflict a lot of self-judgment on you. He's going to inflict a lot of self. He loves using resentment, obviously. He loves it when we resent anything. He loves it when we resent ourselves, other people, the creator, anything. Money, wisdom, you know, schedule. He loves when we resent. Resent is one of his main qualities. He loves it when we resent people. He loves it when we postpone things, when we say that we'll do things later. You know, procrastination, just like the famous word mañana, right? Like to do it tomorrow. He loves it when we do it. He loves it when we don't stick to our commitments. He loves it when we give power to other people. He loves it when we blame other people, right? You know, the famous saying that whenever you point at someone, three fingers are pointing at you. Right? In reality, it's all about you. He's also very strict. So that's why you know, in the book Satan, an autobiography by Yehuda Berg that we have in the center, it's an amazing read. And one of the things that, you know, Yehuda shares there is that Satan loves religion. And religion is meaning a strict structure, meaning you do it without understanding why. Just because they said, or you do something and you don't ask and check in with yourself. Everything that you do should be coming from within you, but you understand that it is spiritually correct. Just like, you know, there's a beautiful teaching that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they were giants in spiritual reality, right? They were spiritual, literally giants, but they didn't have any books to study from. They didn't have any way to learn all this wisdom. So how did they know? They used their intuition. And the reason why their intuition was able to guide them is because of their strong desire. And their strong desire was pointed towards the creator, towards the unification with the creator, towards becoming more and more unified with the creator. So when the opponent is telling you, you know, oh, you don't need to do this. You don't need to do spiritual work. Don't worry about it. Focus more on the physical. He's always going to tell you to focus on the spiritual and not on the spiritual. He's always going to tell you to follow the rules. That's what it says. That's what the right thing is to do. It's not always the right thing to do the right thing. Sometimes, you know, it says there's a beautiful teaching that the halachic rules actually change every day. So they change and they upgrade every single day. There's a beautiful teaching. The creator writes new rules of spirituality every single day. How do you know what to do? You have to ask yourself. There's a beautiful teaching, you know, I love when there's a CD of Karen Berg about soulmates. And the question was about how did Karen and the Rav, how did it happen that Karen was okay with, you know, entering the world of Kabbalah that has so many different rules and so many different limitations, and you need to do this and you need to do that, and this is how you do this and this is how you do that, so many regulations. And the question is, like, You know, Karen comes from a completely secular background. She had absolutely no religious upbringing. She had literally no rules set for her. She was all about spirituality, all about, you know, astrology, reincarnation, meditation, etc. All, everything esoteric. And, you know, how was she okay with accepting so many rules and regulations that the Rav had? The Rav was following all rules and regulations to the T. You know, if you would have seen the Rav, if you read the book To Unlikely People, it was complete opposites, right? The ultra religious and the two ultra liberal and free. You know, how did it merge? And Karen gave a beautiful answer. Karen said, you know, it fits spiritually correct. And that's what Kabbalah is. Kabbalah is about learning the rules of the universe, the spiritual rules of the universe. Then it has to be right. It has to make sense. So all of the rules that she took upon herself, it was because she felt that that brought more harmony to her. That brought more connection to her. And this is a good way for us to understand if we're on the right path or not, if something works for us or not, that you kind of do this test. Does this bring me more balance? Does this bring me more connection? Does it bring me more peace and joy for a long term, or it doesn't? It's a beautiful way, simple test of how you find out what is good for you and what is not. Now, the opponent also loves quick gratification, right? That's one of his main tools. He loves to give us instant light, instant gratification. That is a huge explosion of light. And then, you know, the dark period comes, right? That we don't usually like. So he's always going to tell you, eat the cake, sleep more, judge someone else, do whatever you feel right now. Just do it because you want it. Don't think, don't restrict, don't be proactive. Just do whatever it is that you want. You know, discuss other people, judge yourself, etc. He's going to tell you to be in those modes. He loves fast food. He loves judging you. He loves judging other people. Whatever instant gratifications. There's many, many different ones. So he loves everything that has to do with quick light that prevents you from doing your true spiritual work in the long term. That's another one of his main tools. All about instant gratification, quick light, no need to work for it. He doesn't want you to go inward. He doesn't want you to meditate, for example. Meditation is not something that helps the Satan. You know, it's something that's against him. So he's always going to tell you, there's no need to meditate. There's no need to look within. You don't have to scan Zohar. You don't have to do Ana Bekoach. You don't have to attend the class. You don't have to volunteer. You don't have to give tithing. You don't have to give a donation. He's all about that. It's all about possession also. He wants you to be totally in possessive state. He loves to connect us to physicality, to not give us ability to share. He loves for you to think that I need this because my life depends on it. Does it really? No, obviously. Nothing really depends on it. Our life doesn't really depend on anything except the light force of the Creator. That's the ultimate ingredient for life. Yes, we need air, we need water, we need food, we need housing, we need relationships, etc. But the ultimate thing that needs to go into every single one of those things is the light force, is the Creator. That's what really brings happiness into those things. Another very strong attribute is sadness. He loves to make us sad. He loves to make us melancholic and, you know, sad and, oh, we missed an opportunity and think about the past and, oh, we missed our, you know, I missed my chances. I'm not going to have that chance anymore. I don't have that chance anymore. You know, all about that. He loves it. He loves to dwell on the past. He's all about also the future, constantly thinking things will be better. Things are great. Things are going to be so amazing. You know, things will be amazing, but you're living in the moment right now. That's the only existence that exists. There's no past. There's no future. There's only the present. That's the only thing that exists. That's for me. That's I don't dwell on the past, but I love dwelling in the future. For example, that's one of the ways that my opponent works. He loves to, you know, I love to think about the making plans, but not being very present. Being vulnerable and emotional, that's he doesn't like. He doesn't like when you expose him. He hates it. Our opponent hates it when you bring him into the light. He loves it when you keep him dark in deep in the darkness. He loves it. He loves it. So going on that, I wanted to introduce something new this class. If somebody wants to, and maybe two or three people want to share, we'll take a small break. You can think about it. And if somebody wants to share about their particular opponent, what kind of qualities does he have? What does he make you want to do? Or what does he tell you on a daily basis? Or what does he make you feel on a daily basis? So let's take 20 seconds to think about it. And then if somebody's brave enough, and you are all brave, we're all brave. Nobody's, afraid here to share and to open up in the group. It would be an amazing experience for all of them. So let's take 30 seconds to think about it. And if you want, please raise your hand and I would love to hear from you. Okay, we have any brave Kabbalists? We all are brave, but who wants to be the first one? Who wants to get the most light? Who's the greediest? When we share, that's when we receive the most light. So, and also it will give us a boost in our spiritual practice. So no pressure, but if you, during the class, feel free to either raise your hand or unmute yourself to share. It's a very, very spiritual, very freeing and positive experience. But at least make sure that you are taking this time and not just listening, but also to understand, to find the links between you and your opponent. How is your opponent working with you? What tools does he use against you? Okay, so we mentioned some of the tools. Now let's talk about that he uses. So now let's talk about what we have. But really, I would really love it if somebody shares. And I'm sure you're thinking about it, and you're just like, "No, someone else should do it." No, it's your opponent, by the way, just to let you know. He's always going to tell you, "No, somebody else is going to do it. No, you don't need to do it. No, don't do it. Oh, it's embarrassing." He hates it when we think that we're embarrassing. Even though for the soul, it's one of the most amazing things to kind of express yourself. And I just actually listened to one of our astrologers, Ruth Nachmias, a tool, a simple trick for this time period and for this week is to share something that you never shared. Share something that you never shared with anyone in your life. Somebody that just inside and just like she was like it's just rotting inside of you. And just let it out. Just let it out into the open and let it go and be exposed. So okay, so we know that that's our main job. What are some tools that will help us in our battle against the opponent? So there's many different tools. There's conscious tools, meaning something in the consciousness. There is spiritual tools, meditative tools, and sharing tools. So one way to break the opponent is to be in a state of happiness, like I said. So happiness is something that's totally against the opponent. Happiness is not necessarily to be happy, and to force yourself to be happy most of the day is not something that's relatively easy. But the more you are happy, truly, genuinely, deeply happy, not just on the outside, just smiling and laughing all the time, but truly happy on the inside, you're going to be connected to the light much more if you do that. From the tools, from the physical tools that we have, obviously, the Book of the Zohar. Right? The Book of the Zohar is one tool that when it's open, when we connect to it, the opponent stops having access to us, stops having access to our consciousness, to our energy, to our being. We completely connect to the light. We bring him into his perfected state and we bring us into our perfected state. So a very deep spiritual work, Ana Bekoach. Another physical sharing tool is whenever we volunteer. When you volunteer, when you give of your time for someone else, for something else, for a cause, it's always going to bring you light. Giving donation, giving charity is actually a way that breaks his energy completely. That's why the Kabbalists are so big of recommending everyone to do that, to give of themselves, to give donations, to give tzedakah, to give charity, because it completely breaks his hold on us as well. So we said being vulnerable, being open, going outside of our comfort zone, that we also said. And then another thing that we want to understand is that he also works with addictions. So we want to identify what kind of addictions do we have? What are we addicted to? What gives us light? What gives us pleasure more than the light? For example, when we say, oh, I just need this cup of coffee and it's going to make me happy, and I just need this and it's going to give me so much energy. I just need this light so much. Without it, I can't exist. Or people that, you know, watch TV also. I just want to see a show and then I'll be good. Or people that are addicted to social media, same way. Addicted to social media, addicted to knowing what's going on. Waking up in the morning and first thing is opening up your phone. You know, that's totally, if it's not an emergency, it's totally an opponent. The obvious addictions, the simple ones that we all know, from, you know, drinking, substance abuse, sex, pornography, also very strong addictions. Being addicted to approval from other people. I want people to like me. I want people to accept me. I want people to like me. I want people to love me. There's absolutely no requirement and no way that you're going to be happy because other people love you. There's no way, it's impossible. It's a totally an addiction and totally something that's not going to bring us into a state of, if you are looking for other people's approval, if you're looking for other people's love. So if you're going through your spiritual work and you find out you had an issue with your parent or with an ex-partner or someone else, and you're looking for approval from them, it's a dead end. You're not going to find happiness there. There's no happiness there. There's no way for you to achieve happiness just because somebody else is going to love you. The only beings that you know, that you need to know that love you, is the Creator. The Creator loves you unconditionally, obviously, always. We don't always believe it. The opponent tells us otherwise. It's a work that we have throughout our life. You need to love yourself. That's a major relationship. That's a key major relationship. You need to work on it every single day, on a daily basis. You need to tell yourself, I need to love myself more. I need to accept myself more. I need to be more patient with myself and to be more tolerant with myself on constant daily basis. And also, if you are in a relationship, if it's a very spiritual relationship, you want to work that you love your partner more. You accept your partner more. They love you more, etc. This relationship grows. But no other relationship, not your parents, not your friends, not your coworkers, not your social circle, is important to kind of for you that you they love you. It's not really a thing. Now, another thing that we have this, so if you have any more questions, please ask. But again, so much potential today, especially to really understand, to really imprint, to download the complete understanding of an aspect of spiritual work, which is finding your opponent, revealing him, exposing him, meeting him, being one, you know, being kind of like, in front of him, and like kind of really getting to know your opponent. How well do you know your opponent? You want to set yourself an intention, even right now, set your intention right now, actually, that you want to discover your opponent and see really how does he affect me. Keep asking yourself that question. Don't stop just because the answer doesn't come right away. That's another way that he attacks us, right? Is that we don't get something right away. Also in spiritual matters, when you ask a question, let it go. Ask a question and let it go. Let the universe show you. Let the world show you. Let your soul show you. So ask yourself, how does he really affect me? How does my opponent affect me the most? What is he doing? What is he constantly doing? I did an amazing meditation this Saturday with myself, actually. But it was very powerful. I kept asking, how is my opponent affecting me? What is he telling me? What does he want me to do? How does he want me to feel? What is he doing? What is, if you're not exposing your opponent, you're missing so much opportunity. So much opportunity. He loves to make you worry, etc. I mean, I can give you endless examples of what he wants to do. But it's up to you to start this journey and to start identifying, start asking yourself, what does my opponent want me to do? It feels very strange because once you start addressing him, it's going to feel a little empty. It's going to feel a little voided. He's going to immediately try to hide. It's very hard to pinpoint him, right? He's like, I love the example of, he's like a virus, right? Viruses constantly mutate, right? That's why viruses and bacteria, that's why we need new vaccines, you know, new vaccinations every year, is because a virus constantly mutates, just like the opponent. And by the way, the more chaos we're experiencing in life, it's a sign that we need to address him more and more and more, that we're not addressing him, and we need to address him, okay? So addictions, that's another way how he works, right? He loves to make us addicted. We want to kind of realize that the only thing that we want and the only thing that makes us really happy in the long term is the light force of the creator. It's the truth. And you want to kind of remind yourself on a daily basis, what really will make me happy is the light force. It's not what position, it's not what position I have. It's not what people think of me. It's not what I achieve. It's not what I accomplish. It's all about me and the light, me and the light force of the creator. So that's essential. Addictions, patience, another thing, very, very strong. Because of the full moon, we're in a full moon of Sagittarius, the month of Sagittarius and the moon is in Gemini. It's two signs that have almost zero patience. They have no patience. So we're all going to feel this. Everyone is going to feel like literally they're about to explode of why aren't people getting me? Why don't you understand? Why doesn't it happen right away? Because it's both signs that want things right away. And when things don't come to them or to us right now, right away, we get very frustrated. Like, what do you mean? Why isn't it happening? I'm on it now. Why don't you understand me? What are you, you know, telling someone, oh, what are you, stupid? Like, you know, that's very reactive way to talk, right? Telling somebody, so dumb that you don't understand? It's something very simple I'm asking you or I'm telling you to do. So this is the energy that's kind of like being broadcasted. But at the same time, the understanding and also the elevated Sagittarius and Gemini are very open, they're very wise, they have a lot of understanding, they can see very different aspects and perspectives of everything. Very multifaceted people, very adventurous, very fun, very light, easygoing, very flowing, that's what you want. But you don't want the downside. You don't want the impatience. You don't want the judgment, the criticism, the over-talking, etc. So before we go into the meditation, if somebody wants to share, please feel free. If you want to write or if you want to go ahead and ask the question live or share something. Again, a really amazing. Meanwhile, I'm going to read a section of the Zohar to give us more energy and more connection to Rabbi Shimon. Aval tov niklach ahu de la azle, avatre de yetzara velo itgaya kelal. U ma'ich ruche velibe ureute legabe kadosh baruch hu keden chachu yetzara. Mitchafag le'eved lo. Delo yake leshata'a eloi vechachu barnash shalit aloi kama de'at amar ve'ata timshal bo. You know what, I remembered one thing. He doesn't like us to set boundaries. It's another thing that he doesn't like us to do, is to set healthy boundaries. That's not something that he's very much into. And it's always going to, when we set healthy boundaries with ourselves, with our people, in general in life, the whole idea of having healthy boundaries, that's not something that the opponent likes. Okay, so everyone, somebody's asking a question. You want to, okay, so that's a good, so the question is not, what do you want from me? you want to ask, what does my opponent make me feel? What does he want me to do? What does he, be more specific. Okay, so ask, be very direct. How does my opponent work on me, kind of? What does he use on me? What kind of tools does he use on me? Okay, some people it's very, it's by asking a question. It's just by asking a question, not expecting an answer. Obviously, I don't know who you are. It just says Dell's iPhone, so I don't know who it is exactly, but I don't know if you studied for a while or not. But if you're on a spiritual journey, that's just something you put into your daily practice, is you ask, okay, what does my opponent do, want me to do right now? What does he want me to do? It's much easier to find out what he wants you to do than what the light force wants you to do, because the opponent is always going to be louder. As we learn, he's always the loud voice. He's always the one that tells you, like, do this, you know. He's always the loud one, and the light is always softer, always quieter, always more relaxed, always more comforting. And the opponent is always going to be the first and the loud, you know, the loud one. What do you do when you fight? I hope you took Kabbalah 1-2-3, that you know what to do afterwards. But step one is to acknowledge. Step one is to find out, what does my opponent want me to do? That's the process of self-discovery. Okay. All right. So let's do our meditation. Again, meditation is very simple. It's visualization. It strengthens and enforces everything that we've learned on a conscious level and brings it more to our soul. So it's embedded more in our subconscious. And you want to start by being present. You want to relax. You want to go inward, go inside. And you want to start to go to a place where you're just surrounded by the light force of the Creator. Everything around you is just light. There is no shapes, no people. It's all just the light force of the Creator. And keep going higher into space. And visualize yourself becoming with the light, one with the light. And start to awaken sense of appreciation, peace, joy, love. And here we want to ask ourselves, how does my opponent affect me? What does he want me to feel? What does he want me to say? What does he want me to think? What does he want me to do? How does my opponent affect my consciousness? Do I blame people? Do I judge them? Do I judge myself? Do I cut myself short? Do I settle for less? Do I need to be more disciplined with myself? Bring your consciousness a step away from you right now. Look at yourself from a side. And ask the light, ask the Creator to give you higher perspective, higher point of view of yourself. Ask the Creator to give you ability to appreciate yourself, to admire yourself more, to value your time, your energy. To invest more into yourself. And also we can receive downloads of consciousness. So if you want to know what it means and what it feels like to be patient with ourselves, with other people, with processes in our life, the definition of patience, what it feels like to be patient. Say yes. Now awaken this sense of peace, sense of tranquility, sense of serenity. And try to see yourself going through the same experiences that you did before, but in a completely different way. Almost like you're detached from the process, almost like you're not the same person as people expect you, as you learned yourself to be, and become a totally different being. You are your own creation. We are constantly our own creation. You choose who you are. You choose what you are. You choose what you feel. Another way that the opponent works is he makes us nervous, makes us frustrated, nervous, tense. We want to awaken in the opposite of that. Again, peace, serenity, tranquility, the state of Zen. Then we want to ask the Creator, Creator, help me understand what is the next best version of myself? What is the higher version of myself? What is the next level of myself? How does it feel? How does it look? If I had everything that I wanted, if everything that I dream of would come into my life, how would I feel? Try to experience it. How would you feel? What it would feel like? What it would taste like? What would be that experience? Tell yourself you can be that at any moment. You are that already. There is no future. You are your best version right now. Look at all the people in your life with unconditional love, with appreciation, with gratitude, with tolerance, with acceptance, with patience, and see how every single one of them is only helping you to learn something. Either helping you learn boundaries, learn patience, learn wisdom, learn courage, learn kindness, learn compassion. They are just there to help you learn a lesson. Know that you already have that lesson. You already have the lesson. You already have the quality. You already have the attribute. And sometimes it's hard for us to understand love. So a good word is also appreciation. So make sure that you appreciate yourself. Appreciate yourself. Appreciate your energy. Appreciate your words, your consciousness. Appreciate the Creator. Appreciate that the Creator is everywhere in your life, in every relationship, in every step, in every process. Constantly helping and assisting you. And then you want to return to the space of the Creator, It's unconditional love, it's tingling light. And whenever you're ready, you just want to rinse yourself in this energy, fill yourself up with it again, and open your eyes. Okay, everyone. Thank you for joining. Again, such a special day. If you want to listen to the class again, it's going to be available tomorrow. If you have friends that are interested, that are also Kabbalah.com members or not, that you would think would benefit from this class, please tell them. Sending you so much love, so much appreciation. I'm going to see you next Monday. I'm going to stop the...